Good afternoon, YouTube. So I wanted to make this video to talk about some of the reasons I chose this particular heater. Okay, so I summarized some of the considerations I used in choosing this heater. And when I first started looking at these, I was really overwhelmed by the huge variety of heaters out there. Just Takagi alone, who I used, has 45 different models of tankless water heaters. And there's probably 30 or 40 different manufacturers that each have 30 or 40 different kinds of heaters. And just seeing all of those really was overwhelming. So what I found most useful was to split these heaters up into various categories here so that you can narrow in on what you're looking for. So the very first category would be what sort of fuel the heater uses. So you have electric and gas heaters, propane or natural gas. The electric heaters are generally going to be less expensive, and the gas heaters are going to be more expensive because you have burners and fans and blowers and igniters and venting and all that stuff to deal with. The operating costs are going to depend on your fuel costs and availability. In my case, natural gas comes out to be the least expensive. It's about a quarter of the price of an electric heater. And I don't have anywhere near the electric service to the house to even consider an electric heater. So the next main category is location. So if you're looking at location, you can have your heater outdoors or indoors. So they make two different kinds of heaters. The outdoor heaters require no venting. They'll have an intake vent at the bottom, and they have an exhaust vent at the top. The heater just kicked on. I'm running the dishwasher, so that's the amount of noise the heater makes. But you may have to worry about freeze protection if you're in an area that gets cold. The heaters will have some degree of freeze protection. An indoor heater is going to require venting, and it may also require venting for both the intake and the exhaust. So the next category on water heaters is going to be the rating, the thermal rating, either BTUs per hour or maybe kilowatts. And you might also see things like gallons per minute. I think this is a US specific thing, but you'll find a lot of heaters. Most of the heaters are up in this 190,000 to 199,000 BTU per hour rating. That's an interesting number, and it turns out that if you go 200,000 BTUs per hour or above, that's considered a boiler instead of a water heater. And about the only difference I could find is boilers seem to cost twice as much as water heaters, and they cost a lot more to install. I found these install prices on homeadvisor.com. So there's, like I say, a bunch of heaters up in this range. They're going to cost something like $1,200, give or take, and an average install cost of, say, $700 to $1,300. And then you'll find heaters in the $180, $160, $140. But once you get down to 120,000, which is what my unit is rated at, that's about 37 kilowatts instead of 58. The smaller heater at 120,000 BTU an hour can use half-inch gas line. Now, it'll only put out about 6 gallons a minute, depending on the temperature you're dealing with. The cost was quite a bit less, about $800. In my case, I spent about $200 on installation. But these bigger heaters are going to need maybe 3/4 inch or 1 inch gas line, so 20 millimeter up to maybe 25 millimeter gas line. And if you need a new gas line installed, you're looking at maybe another $500 to $1,000 installation cost for the gas line. I find the BTU per hour heat rating is probably the best way to compare heaters. And as I showed in an earlier video, you can take your gallons per minute of flow that you need, multiply that by your temperature rise. What's your hot water temperature? What's your cold water temperature? And that difference is the temperature rise. Multiply that by 500, and that'll give you your BTUs per hour. Because I find a lot of these manufacturers play games with these numbers here. If you lower the temperature rise, you can raise the gallons per minute. It's probably best to figure out your gallons per minute and your temperature rise, and then figure out how many BTUs per hour you really need. And you don't want to get too small a heater, because then you can't keep up with the demand and you're going to get cold water. But if you get too big of a heater, there's a couple of things that happen. One is you might need a bigger gas line, which costs money. And the other thing that's not very well documented is these are the maximum numbers, but each heater is going to have a minimum heat and flow rate number. On my heater, it's about 10%, about 6/10 of a gallon per minute before the heater turns on. And these bigger heaters, you might be looking at 1 gallon per minute minimum flow before the heater will turn on. So getting too big of a heater, you might not have your hot water turn on if you're used to cracking the hot water valve just a little bit and getting a little trickle of hot water, because that's not going to happen. And then the other thing just down here, that you'll find a bunch of these RV and camping water heaters. They're usually in the 30 to 40,000 BTU an hour rating. They do maybe 1 or 2 gallons a minute for like a camp shower. Going to pay maybe $100 to $250, but those aren't really rated for continuous permanent installation. Oh, and there the heater kicked on again. And so the last two things to look at here are, there are non-condensing and condensing heaters. This applies to the gas units. So non-condensing just means they burn the gas inside the heater and then it goes up the flue. They're generally less expensive than a condensing heater and they're less efficient. You're probably looking at mid 80% efficiency. The condensing heaters, on the other hand, are going to be maybe $100 to $200 more expensive than an equivalent non-condensing unit, but they are more efficient. This one is 93, and some of them go up to 95 or 96% efficiency. And the big way they do that is they are condensing the water vapor that's going up the stack using that hot exhaust to preheat the cold air coming in, and they condense out that water, and then you need the condensate drain that I showed you in the previous video. You'll save about 10% in gas usage. So if you use a lot of gas, it's probably worth the condensing heater. But the other thing that, again, isn't very well documented is what kind of venting does each heater require. So a non-condensing heater needs Category 3 stainless steel venting. Just think of that as really expensive pipe. If all you need to do is put a 90 degree on the top of the heater and go out through a wall, and you know, an outside wall, and vent to the outside just a foot or two away, it's not that expensive, you know, maybe $100 for one of those. But if you have to go up through a complex series of piping and a long distance, this stuff can cost a lot of money. And you buy each piece. Each straight section is pre-made, each angle, each elbow, and you buy every piece separately. And they're all really expensive, and I'll show you a little bit later. I'll talk about the cost. The condensing heaters can use stainless, or you can just get by with PVC plumbing pipe, and that's what I used on my heater, because the condensing heater cools the exhaust gas down to below the boiling point of water, so you can use plastic pipe. So then the final aspect here, independent of condensing and non-condensing is what the vent looks like. There's concentric vents and there's separate intake and exhaust ports. So concentric vents are, like I showed you in the previous video, they use an inner pipe and an outer pipe. And the inner pipe is for the intake and the outer pipe is for the exhaust. That pipe, I'll show you, I'll cut in a screenshot here of a typical web page with those pipes. You're looking at several dollars per inch of that kind of pipe. With separate intake and exhaust pipes, like in my heater, you're looking at maybe $1 a foot, a couple of dollars for each elbow. I think I purchased 10 feet of pipe was about $15. Really pay attention to the venting and what materials you have to use. So just to summarize down here, consider the entire system cost when you are looking at a heater like this. You got to buy the heater. You've got to get gas to it or fuel, either electric or gas. And then you've got to get the exhaust and the intake squared away. So you need to look at all of these factors, because you might find a really cheap heater that requires really expensive venting. You know, for instance, you could get a non-condensing heater, save $200 on the heater, but then you'll spend $200 on venting and you'll end up with a heater that's less efficient than if you bought a condensing one and spent $30 on the venting. You know, what I did then was use all these categories to narrow down your search until you get down to just a few heaters, and then you can pick brand and color and style and features and things like that. So yeah, that's the big thing, is use these categories to narrow down your search. And in my case, I came down to this heater. That was the only one I could find that met all my needs. Not saying that this is the best heater for everybody, but it works for me. So I was able to make use of my existing gas piping and just add a little section. I was able to reuse the existing roof penetrations for the exhaust vent. So I'll put a copy of this file on my Google Drive page, and I'll put a link in the video description. If you have any more questions about tankless heaters, I'm by no means an expert, but go ahead and post up in the comment section below, and I'll try to answer any questions there to the best of my ability. And yeah, if you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up. And I'll put some of the other install videos over here on the left side. And as always, thanks for watching.